please subscribe and don't forget to press the bell icon to get notified whenever we upload a new video.
Welcome back. Well, the markets were only listening to Trump's tariff noises, and so we couldn't pay attention to what was a very resounding victory that we saw for the BJP in the northeastern states. This is probably the first time that most of the northeastern states are with a major national party. And on the other hand, it's the first time that BJP is getting elected with such a huge majority in Christian-dominated, minority-dominated states. That has an impact on both sides. And to check out the impact on the nation, we have with us a long-time observer of the Indian political scene. Shekhar Gupta joins in with his take. Good morning, Shekhar. Thank you very much for joining us. What does this mean for the BJP itself? Now it will be recognized as well as not a party against minorities, but a party that the minorities actually vote for.
Well, Lata, if you don't mind, can I put in an editorial correction and caution there? BJP has not won, I repeat, not won anything in a Christian-dominated minority state. It has won two seats in Meghalaya, maybe one or two in Nagaland. Those are the two Christian-dominated minority tribal states. So BJP has done nothing there except run governments through mergers and acquisition. And the tradition of the Northeast is that whichever regional party comes to power in these very small states, it aligns with whoever is in power at the center. So please don't extrapolate this. It's dangerous to extrapolate this as meaning that BJP has swept Christian, minority-dominated tribal states. It hasn't. I repeat, it hasn't. What BJP has done, on the other hand, which is very significant, is that it has defeated the CPM in Tripura, which is a Hindu-dominated state. And it's doubly significant because Tripura does not have the element of polarization that BJP often looks for, say, in a place like UP or Bihar, which has a sizable Muslim population. Tripura doesn't have that. In spite of that, and that's why this victory is doubly creditable. That's why BJP's victory against CPM is doubly creditable. Also, Tripura's population, a large majority, is Bengali. So there is an implication that this sentiment will now travel to West Bengal. So let's keep the two things aside.
Fair point.
One is BJP just taking control of the Northeast, which is one story. It's the truth. The other is BJP winning in Tripura, but BJP has not won in Meghalaya and Nagaland. Far from it.
Okay. Shekhar, good morning. You know, the most incredible story of this election for me was the BJP vote share in Tripura. I mean, last time they lost almost deposit in all the seats. And to eat entire Congress vote share, I mean, CPM's vote share has still remained at 44-45%. How should one look at that? I mean, how can a party move from 1% or 2% to 45-46%? And does this mean that Congress is increasingly becoming weaker and is not able to capture, you know, spaces where other parties are losing ground?
Well, Tripura election in some ways is the mirror image of Delhi elections, last Delhi elections, where the entire Congress vote shifted to Aam Aadmi Party. Now, the reality there is, I mean, it's a lesson for Congress party, that Congress really does not have an ideological or committed vote anymore. There is a large vote in all states which does not want to go with the dominant party. So a large vote in Tripura is essentially the anti-left vote. Left is a polarizing party, just as the BJP is a polarizing party. So similarly, in Delhi, a lot of people would not vote for BJP. They do also by default vote for Congress. In Delhi, Congress might have some loyal vote also. But in Tripura, Congress organization has completely disappeared. It has ceded the entire space to the BJP. In fact, most BJP MLAs and most BJP leaders locally are people who've moved away from the Congress party. So BJP is the new Congress in Tripura. Having said that, in the past 30 years, Congress had only won power once in Tripura, and that too, there was a shady history Preceding that, there was a misuse of intelligence agencies, the security situation, Tripura was then insurgency hit. Congress exploited that to come to power. So it was really not a Congress state. So yes, BJP has got all of the Congress vote, but it has also been able to take another 8 or 10 percentage point vote away from the left front. Okay. And that is always the middle of the road marginal vote that decides in a country like India, first past the post, who rules the state.
Okay, Shekhar, good morning. This is Sonia here. So after the Northeast victories, do you think that the probability is very high of the BJP forming governments, not only in West Bengal, as the viewpoint is, but also in other states like Karnataka, Kerala and Odisha?
Well, I think let's not get ahead of ourselves. I think the problem with the markets is that people in the markets allow their voting preferences to get the better of their judgment. I mean, it's too early. Tripura is a two Lok Sabha state. And then, as I repeat again, BJP has not won a single seat in Nagaland. BJP has won two in Meghalaya. So be careful, because each state is different. Nagaland is very different, Meghalaya, Tripura, but that besides, Karnataka is a different kettle of fish. Yes, BJP will now have tailwind going into Karnataka because they've just suffered setbacks in these by-elections, important by-elections in Rajasthan, to a slightly lesser extent in Madhya Pradesh, but definitely Rajasthan was a very rude shock for them. So they will take heart from their win in Tripura. They are being able to acquire the leading regional parties in Meghalaya and Nagaland is no story, because if Congress was in power in Delhi, they would have done it. Okay. And I will give you the example of an Arunachal government, which over a three-year period had become had been a part of three leading governments in Delhi, Congress, United Front and BJP. So that's how smaller states in the Northeast go. But to extrapolate this to Kerala, West Bengal, Karnataka, it may happen, but to do it today is a leap of faith.
Okay. By the way, just want to point out that the Bank Nifty is seeing a big intraday pullback now, and after defending the 200-day moving average, only 70 points lower. HDFC Bank is leading that move. My sense is a lot of stop losses would have got triggered, and once the high of the day was taken out, so the HDFC Bank stock doing well right now. Shekhar, the other interesting bit is this UP by-election. BSP normally does not fight by-election, so for now they are supporting the SP, but should we look at 2019 a united opposition, because that remains the big risk, right, for the BJP?
Well, this is definitely an indication that something that this thought is on people's minds. Remember, in the past, BSP has aligned with both Mulayam Singh and the BJP. I think when they aligned with the BJP slogan was Hathi Nahi Ganesh Hai, Brahma Vishnu Mahesh Hai. And I think when they aligned with Mulayam, Kashiram embraced Mulayam, I think it was like Kashiram, Mulayam Singh or Kashiram, Khatam Ho Gaye Jai Shri Ram or something like that. So BSP has played on both sides of this divide. So once again, this is an interesting sign right now. Gorakhpur, I think the margin is too high. It's the chief minister's own constituency, so I don't even think that even a combined vote will make such a difference. So it's symbolic. In Phulpur, a combined vote can make a difference, although the, you know, the power of recent incumbency for the chief minister in a by-election is very, very formidable. I think it's an early sign, but once again, much will happen between now and 2019. In fact, I won't be surprised if over the next few weeks, ED and CBI, the usual suspects, discover some, you know, dust up some old cases against Mayawati, and the story may begin to change. That's a predictable pattern of UP politics. Once again, everybody's played this game.
Okay. Well, we'll have to wait and see. It's a long time before the general elections come on, and there are several state elections in between, but clearly a spring in the step for the BJP in Northeast. Thank you very much, Shikhar Gupta for putting things into perspective and correcting wrong perspectives as well. Let's see how things shape up from here on. For the moment, we have to shift focus back to markets. And here, the big theme now is the recovery in the Nifty Bank, as Anuj was pointing out, now getting almost into green today.
Oh, yes, just about 55 point lower is what we have. You know, my sense is that, as you saw the intraday chart, you know, as soon as the high point was taken out, though, there was some bit of covering. But we have Ashwini Gujral, Mitesh Thakkar and Prakash Gaba now joining us. Ashwini, your sense of things so far, and on the Nifty and the Bank Nifty, what's the trade now?
See, this is called noise, and we have recovered to Thursday's low on the Bank Nifty. And if you recall, Thursday afternoon there was a large decline, so this is a consolidation of that decline. And you should try to go short here, because as the Bank Nifty, etc., these things rise, the risk reward becomes much better. The way to look at it is, why should the bear fear? So he's got global cues on his side, he's got local cues on his side. So these are the kind of rallies that you will find the bears taking advantage of. And yes, three stocks have moved into the green, etc. I don't think that is often very sustainable. So this is the right time to, you know, get short and remain short. As far as individual stocks are concerned, JSPL is a sell with a stop of 242, target of 227. Thomas Cook is a buy with a stop of 242, target of 263. And India Bulls Housing is a sell with a stop of 1260, target of 1200. And as we speak, HDFC is again starting to make lows of the day. And the moment it starts to do that, you know who's coming.
All right. Mitesh Thakkar and Prakash Gaba are also here with us. Prakash, hi, good morning. Now down to the low point, down almost 90 points on the Nifty. What's your view on how to approach individual stocks?
Nifty certainly is weak. We've seen a massive down move. What we are seeing is just a pause in the down move. I think the low will be taken out and we'll see maybe around 10,097. It's a matter of time is going there. So we may get rallies. Those rallies would be shorting opportunities. Short it and hold it for a day or two. So far, still looks weak to me. I have two shorting ideas here. IB Realty is looking weak to me. Indbull Realty can slide to levels closer to around 108 zones. Sorry, to around 204 zones. Stop about 213 should be fine. And I also like PVR from the shorting space. Can see a slide to around 1,250 zones, stop above 1,300.
Okay. Mitesh, your trades?
So I still have a negative bias and I have two sell calls, both from the oil and gas sector. I think ONGC is a sell with a stop at 190 for targets of 178, and Gas Authority is a sell as well. Keep a stop at 449, look for targets of 430.
Ashwini, would you want to sell any of the individual banks, or are you only selling the Nifty Bank?
See, basically any bank that's moved into the green can be sold. Like ICICI Bank was up 0.3% at one point, now it's in the negative. State Bank, BOB, etc. PNB is up almost 0.8. So all these rallies, you know, they will get fairly strongly sold into. But I think the private banks are where, you know, the big FI selling and the big guys come in to sell. So, you know, maybe IndusInd Bank, Axis Bank, HDFC Bank, those can also be sold. Yeah. PSU banks are, you know, fairly strongly sold already. So maybe for a few days they can move sideways and go up and down a bit. But I think the other financials like HDFC, HDFC Bank, etc., they are also moving lower. One interesting thing is coming to my mind. Mm. That, you know, why isn't the IT index up 100 points? The tariffs which are now imposed on metals, can't they be imposed on the pharma and the IT space? We just need to wait for our turn. So maybe some amount of that could also start get pricing in.
Okay. Fair point.
Well, at the moment, there's also a dollar weakness which is not working in their favor.
Oh, yes. By the way, I just want to point out a couple of other interesting tidbits. Housing finance is doing well today. So stocks like LIC Housing, Canfin Home, Repco, they have moved to high point. And the other interesting bit of trade which keeps coming back is some of these tire stocks. MRF once again is making highs of the morning. Ashwini, for some of these companies, especially the commodity consuming companies, is there a bit of a reverse trade?
See, the problem is that the market's back is broken. So all these cute trades are, you know, half an hour, 2 hour trades. The big, you know, thrust of this market is on the downside. And now exporters, which were kind of holding on, are also facing the heat. I think the big trade remains on the downside.
Okay, gentlemen, thanks a lot for joining us. We need to take a short break. When we come back, we'll talk about the commodity space. Manisha Gupta will join in with some trades.